It's 7:30 a.m. and today it's a little bit of a weird day. On the way back to the airport, I couldn't stay away, just driving through downtown Los Angeles. Today is all about maintaining my status on United Airlines, so I make the 1K level, which affords me a much easier travel situation in the coming year. I'm gonna be doing a lot of traveling for solo concerts, for touring, for clinics, for all kinds of stuff all over the world. And making that top tier of the United Mileage Plus program gives me these benefits, gives me these upgrades, baggage allowances, all kinds of things that really kind of ease the burden of traveling. It's the 29th of December today. And this is the first time I've had to take a flight before the cutoff, which is December 31st at midnight. It's the first time I've had to take a flight to make the requirements for the status. The miles, I smashed. I did plenty of miles this year to break the 100,000 mile in 12 months barrier. But United introduced a dollar requirement in terms of how much money you have to spend on tickets in a calendar year. And that is now $12,000 in 1 year. And I went to Japan with Peter Erskine earlier this year and they flew me business class, which was very, very kind of them. But I didn't get the dollar credit, which was a really expensive ticket actually and would have totally smashed the goal months and months ago. I would not be doing this trip today had I been given the credit for that flight. But I didn't get the credit for that flight because the promoter booked it on like a bulk group travel agent type rate, which is unfortunately not eligible for credit. So here I am. I was $282 short of the $12,000 and I'm running up to San Francisco and back. Really quick flight, out and back, same day. And rather than just be this weird day of having to fly to make this requirement for the status, I managed to get in touch with a really great friend of mine, one of my favorite people, one of my favorite drummers in the world, who lives up in the Bay Area, and I'm gonna sit down with him and interview him for my podcast. We haven't seen each other in a few years. It's gonna be a great hang. So it's not just a weird day of flying up to San Francisco to make this quota. I actually managed to do some work, and I'm sure it'll be fun walking around the city, eating some good food, taking some nice footage for the vlog. That'll be cool. I've given myself a solid few hours in the middle of the day to be in the city, to do this interview for the podcast, and to roam around and do some exploring. I'm traveling super light, just have the camera and my backpack. I think it's gonna be a little chilly up there, but here's hoping for a nice, easy, smooth day of travel, straight up, do the work, and come straight back. LAX during the holiday season, not the most envious place on earth to be. Incredibly busy here, even in the middle of the week. I guess people are gearing up to go away for the weekend for New Year. Luckily, I don't have to go too deep into the airport. I can sneak around the cut through and get into the Terminal 7 parking lot and hopefully breeze through security. Hand luggage only, already have my boarding pass, already checked in. Actually have some time to hang in the new United Lounge at LAX. Last time I was here, didn't have that. And they have an outdoor patio, which is kind of nice. You always feel like you're kind of encased in an airport in a box and there's no way out. So it's kind of nice to have this little outdoor patio. Well, that's my plane over there. I'm actually outside at the airport now, very cool. Patio situation, but I'm gonna go jump on my plane and head up to San Francisco. All right, here we go. First flight of the day. Back in the US where first class or business class actually means something. A bigger seat, a meal,
all kinds of little perks. Very relaxed way to go to San Francisco. And a huge part of why I'm doing this trip today as well. Love the fact they have a subway train that goes all the way from the airport to downtown San Francisco. They definitely like their hills here in San Francisco. And I definitely appreciate the workout. It's nice sitting in the car on the way to the airport, sitting on a plane. It's nice to get out and walk a little bit, get the legs moving. Time for a little Japanese food. San Francisco's always been pretty well known for that as far as I remember. And I think I've been to this place before and it was pretty killing. So let's find out. I'm in San Francisco, so why not do a Q&A Golden Gate Bridge edition? First of all, unbelievable comments and words and everything from yesterday's vlog. I can't thank you enough for that. That was really, really overwhelming. I appreciate you guys discussing, commenting, talking, thinking, all the rest of it. To those people who apologized for asking a personal question, don't ever apologize for that. You know, it was me who chose to answer it. And no matter what the question, you know, I can at the end of the day choose whether to answer it or not. So, all good. If it helps to incite creative discussion and communication, then so much the better. That's kind of what I'm here for. That's what I try and do. First question, Todd asks, do I rely on muscle memory and shapes to play certain arpeggios and scales, or am I able to recite the notes off the top of my head for a B flat Dorian or D flat minor seventh chord? Todd says he struggles with how much information regarding scales and arpeggios he needs to commit to memory. The muscle memory comes from a repetition of playing those shapes and sounds. So I'm never thinking about the notes of the scale. I'm never thinking about the parts I'm never thinking about the elements that make up an arpeggio, for instance. It's all from, you know, if I'm playing a minor major arpeggio in two octaves and I'm playing it fluidly and fluently, it's because I've done it so many times and because I've got so much repetition of that without thinking about it. You know, you have to think about it a little bit or understand it in the beginning when you work that into your practice routine or into your learning process. But once you've kind of got B flat minor major seven arpeggio together, you don't have to think about each element of that arpeggio if you've practiced it over and over again. And of course, if you're practicing it within the context of music and with the context of composition or improvisation or melody or whatever that might be. So no, I don't think about any of those elements theoretically when I'm playing, and I highly recommend for you to do the same thing. Don't think while you play. It's more about doing and not about thinking. So just do. Don't think. Next question comes from Andrew Bowers. He says, when you have an exercise session that did not go as well as you had hoped, do you find that the performance of the exercise session translates out into your practice / gig life? If so, how do you compartmentalize? I think by exercise session, you mean actually physical exercise, right? Like when I'm in the gym or something. I'm gonna answer the question, you know, assuming that that's what you mean. I honestly can't remember the last time I had a training session or a physical exercise session that didn't kind of go pretty well, you know? Being in the gym doesn't have to be crazy technical. I don't put a huge amount of stress on getting everything completely perfect and, you know, although form is so important and the process and how I've kind of honed my process in the gym to suit me and to suit what I want to get out of it, I don't put a crazy amount of pressure or stress on myself when I'm there. So I don't actually remember the last time an exercise session like that really hindered the rest of my life. Now, let's also answer the question, assuming you were talking about base exercise. You know, when it comes to exercise and fundamentals and those kind of things, they don't take up a huge amount of my practice time. So, you know, we're maybe talking about 5, 10, 15, maybe 20 minutes of warm-up. So I'm trying to get past the fundamentals of the instrument and the maintenance and get into music as fast as possible. So it's very rare that when I'm working on exercises on the bass that they really have a derogatory effect on the rest of my playing or on my gigging. So two ways of answering that question. It is really not that warm out here. I think I'm going to call it a day for the Golden Gate Bridge Q&A edition and get across the other side of the bay to Oakland and see my buddy Celso and interview him for the podcast. I can't wait. He's one of my favorite drummers in the world, one of my great friends, and this is going to be an awesome afternoon talking to him about music and about life.
Yeah, dude.
Oh my God. What did the cat brought Jits in?
What's up, man? How are you, buddy? So good, man.
Looking good.
So we're in Oakland.
We're in Oakland, California.
I'm here with Celso.
It's great to have you here, dude, man. It was a surprise. It's a last minute call.
It's so good. And like we talked like maybe a month ago on the phone.
That's right. I call you. It was
you
like,
call me.
Yeah.
You had found a recording of something.
Exactly.
Of us.
Of us playing with,
Neto. Steve Winwood and Neto.
Exactly. In Guiding Power.
Guiding Power, you can.
There's no way around it. She was watching PewDiePie and now she's no longer on YouTube.
Okay.
That was really embarrassing.
Wow. Celso is one of my favorite people. That was just so much fun. Great interview. Man, he came up with so much good stuff. I cannot wait to edit this podcast and get it out there. Here goes nothing. I gotta get on the BART and get over to the airport. Let's see how this works out. Busy at LAX. I hope this is not a sign of the traffic to come on the way home right now. I made it home. Operation 1K status on United was a great success today. It was a really fun day in San Francisco. It's 10 o'clock. I'm gonna edit the vlog, repack all my bags in time to get back to the airport first thing in the morning for the next adventure. All which will be revealed in tomorrow's vlog.